can stay, but you're savage love. Did somebody break your heart? Looking like an angel, but you're savage love. When you kiss me, I know you don't get two fucks, but I still want that. You're savage love. You're savage love, love, love.
Friends, welcome once again to this recording. For those who are here for the first time, my name is Launa K, or rather Launa Kavinamoto. I'm a Namibian YouTuber, and today we are continuing talking about my adoption story. But this is not going to make sense if I have not shared with you about the foundation and what led to that. And for you to understand my story more, please go back in memory lane, check my videos, and you'll understand me more. Otherwise, thank you for coming by. For the new subscribers, please thank you. Don't only watch, but hit that subscription button, you know, the ring button, and share and leave a comment below. And for my old subscribers, thank you for continuation of watching and sharing and liking. I love you, and I cannot do without you guys. So guys, as we are, you know, targeting by December to have 1,000 subscribers, and we are going to have giveaways, first, second, and third prizes. So continue to share, like, subscribe. I love you guys. So let's go into the story. Yes, guys. So then I was like saying that we must, you know, stay out of people's stories who are married and they cannot have children. We just don't understand. So like in my case, people just don't understand, you know. You must understand that I come from a family where, let me start from my Mekulu Helena, Mekulu Francina, my mother, and myself. Let me start from, I'm the fourth generation. My children is the fifth. My great-grandmothers, there were only two siblings. There were only two sisters. The others probably died, or I don't know, but I just heard about there were two. There were actually three. Martha, Helena, and their brother. So now you must understand that Martha gave birth to, if more, only to four. And where I come from, my great-grandmother, you know, gave birth to six. You know, three women and then three men. Then you must understand now, these six children of my late grandmother the first one is my grandmother. So my grandmother had fertility issues. So by the grace of God, she gave birth to my auntie. And then after 19 years plus 20, that's when my mother was born. Imagine you are 20 years old, and that is when your mother is getting your younger sibling. And after 2 years of my mother's existence, then my grandmother died. So then you must understand now, her younger sister, Mekulu Mkwane Kamba, the sole survival now, she gave birth to, if I'm not mistaken, to 14 children. And then the one that followed my grandfather have two sons who are now an American descendant. And the one who followed my other grandfather, uncle grandfather, he had probably six, seven. And then come the other sister who got, I think there were four. And then my youngest aunt grandma had 12. So you must understand, and coming back to my grandmother's lineage. So my grandmother had two children. My auntie and mom was the youngest. So then my eldest auntie, mom's elder sister, she was able to conceive only in her 40s, and she has her only child, my cousin Sarah, my immediate cousin. So then mom gave birth to us five children, Okay, my auntie gave birth to one and mom gave birth to five. So as five, my elder brother, I'm not so sure, but it's like he does not have children of his own. And my elder sister got five children like mom and like our grandmother, great-grandmother. So, and I follow and I gave birth to only one biological child. And my younger brother gave, have only have two sons. And my younger sister have only two. Now, tell me, for you to come and say, I miscarried, I did abortions, is maybe because of the contraceptive. Then I don't know where you got that, but again, it's your right to conclude, you know, according to how you see me or how you view me. So guys, so I come from this background, and when I was like having my daughter, one of my main prayer was like, God, if she can only have children, open her womb. I started praying for her when she was very, very young. And glory be to God, she is having two beautiful daughters, of which we believe in our... When she was getting married, I remember my auntie praying for her, wishing her best. They were like, please, God, God must give her a daughter. And then when I told them, no, she got a daughter. And then she said, we are praying for another daughter again, because they believe... girls or female children are like a wealth because they are expanders of a clan. So they now believe that my clan will be expanded because my biological child is a daughter and the her children are also daughters. So glory be to God. Father, I give you the praise. Hallelujah. Okay, fine. So now you know where I come from. Okay. Yeah, okay, yes, so this is how we have been, as I told you that my, the girls that I was keeping in the house, they started mocking me in a way, and my ex-husband's family started treating me like a nobody, and guys, I was just feeling out of place, and I found myself on depression treatment. I found myself just sold out for Christ, and the only place I could feel joy was when I was busy with the work of God and things like that. So here is the signs that I now realize that something was about to go wrong in my head due to these fertility issues. Guys, it's not easy for us. Even if you see us pretending like, no, we are fine of not have given birth to our... In our marriages, no, we are not fine. It's not in the human nature. It's not. God made us to conceive. God made us to bear children. And now you come and find yourself not bearing the second one, but one. Now, when I was going through this with my ex-husband and his family and people around me, I was caught up into a web, and a spider web. And I want to call that an ungrateful spider web. You know, I removed my focus from my biological child. I did not see again that I'm having this child, and the devil came to tell me that, and somehow I felt like she was my sibling. I loved her with all my heart. I knew I carried her, but somehow I felt like she was my sibling because I cannot remember really. You know, when you give, when you conceive as a teenager, you know, the system or the people that you are around with, they don't allow you to experience, to enjoy that baby kicking. You know, you find some people, you know, holding their stomach. Oh, look at the baby. You are not allowed because they were like, yeah, so you are holding your baby. So which means you have enjoyed it. And they use the vulgar language. So which means when you are sleeping, you are enjoying it. They wanna, you know, they want to make you feel your child is trash, your child is nothing. And that is why I have a challenge with my elder sister. You know, when her first daughter conceived, you know, it was out of wedlock. For me, I allowed that girl to enjoy her pregnancy because I told myself I would not allow any pregnant people around me to go through what I went through. And when the second one also conceived, guys, I'm like, what can we do? This person, the baby is now here. Because guys, this is a little bit of how my mom also treated me. But what I did not like was the life after when you have conceived. So then I realized in the black culture or Sivambo culture, what they do is during pregnancy, most of them, they treat you well because apparently they don't want you to lose the baby. But when the baby is out, they don't allow you to enjoy your baby. They don't allow you to connect because you are being sent here, you are being sent that, you are being shown how slutty you are and how you have allowed yourself to fall pregnant, to give birth to this thing. Oh my God, Father have mercy. The people who have treated me like I was nothing. Anyway, guys, so this is my stories that I've gone through. So I went through the operation, as I told you, through the surgery. When I was in Bible school, I would question God. While I was questioning God, one day my young sister just called and she said, she mentioned in Oshivambo, she said, Melona, pandulaka lunga, wenda moka nyofi, vakwe nivamwina vendamo. Meaning, my elder sister, thank God you have been in the labor room whereby others had not the chance to enter. Guys, that thing hit my spirit, soul, and mind. Oh my God, that was God using my younger sister. I was like, oh my God, I started repenting. I started saying, God, I'm really, really sorry. God, I'm sorry. Forgive me, Lord. Forgive me, forgive me. And I started seeing my daughter with a different eye. And I'm like, man, this is what God had for me. And I was like, Launa, remember what the doctor said? Thank God for that. I started loving my daughter, not as my sibling, but as my child. I started loving my child with all my heart, guys. Woo-hoo! And after that call, nobody could touch my child. You touch my child, you touch me. I remember there was a day I was in the house and my ex-husband's brother had the audacity to beat my child. Oh my God. Hey, I came in front of that tall guy. I said, listen here. When I was in the labor room, I was bleeding alone. You were not there. Next time you touch my daughter, be ready to touch me. So guys, you need to surround yourself with people who can remind you of the goodness of God, who can remind you that the little that you have, it's enough. What about others who could not obtain it? So guys, 98, I came from Bible school. I told to 99, I went through the surgery to no avail. So one day we were walking, coming from the hospital, and this stress has caused me to have some backache. This stress has caused me to have some stomach cramp. I was constantly having headache, constantly having stomach cramps, constantly. I was just, and with this depression, sometimes I'll be given pills and I'll just slip away. This is how my previous maid was having something with my ex-husband. And also, I'm going to talk about that, about maids, how to watch out for maids when the time is right. So, guys, so I was coming from the hospital, and I was coming with my daughter from the hospital with Esther. She was 11 years old. I remember very well. So you must understand, guys, mom came to tell me to stop this in 1999, 2000. Mom passed away. May her soul rest in peace. But before her passing on, I shared with her. I said, mom, I think I'm contemplating to adopt. And then she said, no, you must not adopt because this, the tradition and whatsoever. So for me, as long as you bring in tradition, then you are telling me go for it. But if you bring a culture, I will understand. But tradition, no. Because culture is a way of telling the world where I am, who I am, where I'm from, and where I'm going to. Guys, today's generation, please differentiate between a culture and tradition. A culture is a lifestyle, and I believe a tradition is a belief, is a faith. Okay, I'll leave it there. So then I've told her, so 2000, mommy passed away. May her soul rest in peace. Around December, 12th December, mom passed away. So, and then guys, I think 2001, somewhere in the beginning of the year, my daughter said, "Mom, when are you going to get us?" You know, she was very bubbly. My girl was very bubbly, you guys. And she was like, "Mom, when are you going to get a sibling for me?" Oh, it has hit my heart, guys. I told her, I don't know that she can remember, but we started having heart talks from the time when she was five, to an extent where I had to share with her why I'm not with her biological father. And there was times when I will go and have my turns when I was young, when I would go to the club and coming back, and then mom will be la da 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 da, and then she'll come to me when she was three and she'll be like, "Mom, don't go again, nah." You know, we were kind of, siblings, friends, So anyway, then she asked me, "Mom, when are you going to get a sibling for me, guys?" It was really hard. And I told her the story. I said, "You know, Mom, you know why Mom is going to the hospital, why Mom went to sleep in the hospital the other day is because of this and that. And Mom is not going to be able to have a child of by her own unless by the miracle of God." Guys, you must understand, we people with fertility issues, we people that living with fertility issues, we are just like somebody living with HIV, living with cancer, living with diabetes, living with hypertension. It's just an epidemic like any other. And now when we live with that, it does not mean that we have lost faith in God. No, it means we are waiting on God. And while we are waiting on God, that is when we think of adopting, because otherwise, you know, you will be waiting and the time will not be useful. So the time while you are waiting on God's timing, whether yes or never, you find yourself, you know, helping somebody, helping a human being through adoption, whether you adopt a sperm, whether it's a baby, whether it's a grown-up somebody, whether you do charity and you do philanthropist work, you know, you are using that time while you are waiting on God. Like Hannah, she was using that time to go to the temple, to go and speak to God, to go, and I'm sure there were some things she was doing, only that the Bible did not record, because not all of the stuff were recorded. Yes. So, and exactly how Hannah felt. And most of the time, the husbands, good husbands, like my current husband, will be like, if this thing has to mess up with your health, then I rather having you alive than trying to conceive and dying in the process. So guys, so my daughter asked me, and I was like, "Oh my God, this thing is serious." So this is how I came to a place where I started praying, I started consulting about adoption, I started, you know, reading more, I started doing my research. That time internet was not really there, but I was reading books. When I found a magazine speaking about adoption, I will read and I will just ask, and so on. And during that time, God brought it to me a mother who was she told me about a story where she was working at the restaurant and how a woman came and dropped a baby there, and how she went through the social worker and how she adopted the child, and how this adopted child is more caring than her biological children, and the whole thing. And not knowing that my actual neighbor that I was telling about wanting to adopt, she too is an adopted child. And you know, and she only find out when she was maybe in her late 20s. So guys, I was just having, you know, doing my research and so on. And I share with my ex-husband. He bought into the idea. He said, "No, it's fine." And you must understand, the surgery that I went through, you know, we were many of ladies that went through that surgery, and many of them, their stories were successful. And mine and few of others, it was different. So my ex-husband decided, okay, we are going to adopt. So we went through the process. Then I wanted to adopt my niece. So then the social worker said, "No, adopting your niece will bring future challenges with your elder sister or whoever the mother of the child would be. Why don't you adopt a stranger, and by the way, a smaller baby who's probably a day old? So this is how the social worker helped us through, and she counseled us, and after 6 months, then this baby was born. But then now you must understand, this 6 months was 6 months of agony, because I gave up and kind of not, I'm not, and I promised my daughter that we are going to get you a sibling, and how, I don't know, and this is a process. So now, and then they ask us, would you like to have any child? I said, yes, any child, as long as the child must not have a disability or HIV positive, because I know myself, I don't think I'll be able to bear that. So they said yes, but they did not tell, they did not ask what race. Yeah, I think they asked, and then I said, as long as it's also not, no, they didn't ask what race. So once we were approved, I started buying baby clothes, doing shopping for baby clothes. You know, I started buying the pram. I started, you know, preparing myself. And you know what? Going through an adoption process is also a healing process, because you find yourself, I call myself, I also was carrying this baby 70%. I felt like the baby was with me. I felt this child close from wherever this child was. You know, I felt so close to this child, even though I've never seen her or him. So guys, we started buying baby clothes, and my wish was to have a boy. So because my first child, I wanted to have a boy, and she came out a girl. And now this one, I was like, wow, a boy. So we started buying blue stuff and so on. So guys, and in the process, a baby was born by somebody who was with NBC, who was working with NBC. Okay, so, and a baby was born, and was told, no, somebody worked with NBC, gave birth to a child, and she's not ready to be with a child due to some certain reasons. So, and it was a boy, very handsome. So, and then while we were in the process, getting to love the boy, going to the children's home to go and check out the boy, and Cuban doctors just came, and they took the boy. Yo, my heart was crushed, guys. Wow, my heart was crushed. So this boy, I think, is now in Cuba or wherever I am. So then I was consoled. No, don't worry. What is yours is yours. So the actual week came. It was around about July. This time like this. It was around about July. So then I remember going to my friend, and my friend gave birth to a baby boy, and I told the Lord, I said, God, if my child is not gonna come this week, then I am done, then I am fine, then it is a sign that you don't want me to adopt. But for more information, tune in for the last episode of my adoption story. Don't forget to subscribe, like, share, and leave a comment below. Thank you for watching through the end. Thank you for following. I appreciate you, guys. Let's make a 1,000K by December. I love you, family. You are a blessing. And thank you. Thank you. Thank you for watching. Please see you on the other side. The third story and the last about my adoption story. I am Launa K, rether Launa K, Namibian YouTuber. See you next time.